the board Marcia gave me is a
Well, happy Thanksgiving to everybody. Hope you've had a great week and a good chance to be able to get together with maybe a little smaller numbers this year, but still be able to give thanks to the Lord for His goodness to us. And so that's kind of what we're going to do today, too. A little bit later in the service, we're going to have an open mic time and a chance for you to be able to come and say, I want to publicly thank God for, and then you can fill in the blank. And so we take kind of a tradition we do every year this on this particular weekend. So we're glad that you're here to be with us. We are going to be having a baptismal service coming up. We had it scheduled for next Sunday, but decided it would work out better for the 13th, the second Sunday in December. If you're interested in being baptized, having trusted Christ as your Savior, talk to us and we'll get the water warm and ready to go. We'll be pulling in the water trough for that one. So today I want to give you an opportunity to meet somebody here, and Ryan Wilson's going to come up. I saw he put a post on Facebook, and I thought, you know, he ought to share that. That's really some good insight. So, Ryan, why don't you come on up, and he's got a scripture verse, and he's going to share with us to kind of get us going here today. Oh, yeah, you're good. Did I get that going? It helps if it turns it on. There you go. Perfect. You might have to get pretty close to it there.
All right. Yeah, so I was just reading in Luke the other day, and God showed me when Jesus cleansed the 10 lepers, so I'm going to read it to you, and you can follow along. It's in Luke 17, verse 11 through 19. Now it happened as he went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Then he entered a certain village. There met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. So when he saw them, he said to them, Go, show yourselves to the priests. And so it was that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, returned and with a loud voice glorified God, and fell down on his face and his feet, giving thanks, and he was a Samaritan. So Jesus answered and said, Were there not 10 cleansed, but where are the 9? Were there not any found who returned to give glory to God, except for this foreigner? And he said to him, Arise, go your way, your faith has made you well. So, I was looking through this and trying to figure out what I want to share, and there's so many applications you can put into this. It's amazing, but the main point is, you know, Jesus is able and willing to heal our sin, whether it's physical, and in my case, it's not really physical. God's blessed me with a good, healthy body, but more of a just internal sin and the stuff that we can struggle with, and just coming to Him and crying out like these men did, and they were faithful to do so. So I just have some key words that I kind of, key phrases I took out of this. And they cried out and they asked for mercy, these lepers. And Jesus, you know, had mercy on them, and He was faithful. He cleansed them. He, you know, we had only one that came back and gave thanks. And that's what we need to be doing, is giving thanks for what Jesus has done for us. And, you know, he blesses even unbelievers. It's amazing, you know. So I have some questions kind of from what I asked myself through this, and you should ask yourself in this. First question is, where is your faith? Is it in Jesus? These men had strong faith, you know. When he sent these men, you know, to go tell the priests that they were healed. He hadn't actually healed them yet. He, you know, these men believed that they would be healed, and they were healed on the way to tell the priests. So they obviously had strong faith. So where is your faith? And second is, am I crying out for mercy for my sin in my life? Am I recognizing what my sin is, and have I cried out and asked God to heal it? And thirdly is, have I been healed? If not, am I still crying out? And if so, am I at his feet thanking him? We always have a job to do. Whether it's thanking him for what he's done in our lives, or we should be praying about what we need in our lives. So, anyways, big main point is just give thanks to what he's done in our lives, and he is willing and able to heal. So, that's all I got.
Thank you, brother. Appreciate that. Cry out for mercy, and God shows mercy to us. So, wonderful thing. So, Bonnie, why don't you bring the worship team on up, and you all get ready to lead us in some Thanksgiving songs. We've got one that's very familiar, and I think you've heard it a lot of times. Then we're going to do a little older one that I requested, and the worship team's been working on it hard, trying to say, you get them so old, and it's like brand new to everybody. So, I haven't heard it before, but let's thank the Lord, and we'll worship him together. Our Father, we are grateful for your goodness to us, all your gracious gifts that come from above. And Lord, we thank you most of all for the gift of your Son, our Savior. And we want to glorify him today as we sing and give praise to you for what you have done and are doing in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you would like to stand, please do so.
With a grateful heart, give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart, give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks. Jesus Christ, his Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich. Because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks. Give thanks. Give thanks.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Come, ye thankful people, come. Raise the song of harvest home. All is safely gathered in. Storms begin. God our Maker doth provide for our wants to be supplied. Come to God's own temple, come. Raise the song of harvest home. All the world is God's own field, fruit unto his praise to yield. We lift hands together so, unto joy our sorrows grow. First the plain and then the ear, then the full corn shall appear. Lord of harvest, grant that we wholesome grain and pure may be. Even so, Lord, quickly come to the final harvest home. Gather thou thy people in, free from sorrow, free from sin. In the presence to abide, come with all thine angels, come, praise the glorious harvest home.
Hey, you did it. You pulled off that old one. That's a good one. All right. Thank you, worship team. They're going to come back and sing a couple more for us at the close of the service today after we have a time of sharing. I'd like to invite you to turn with me, if you have your Bible, to Psalm 118. Psalm 118. I had a dear friend of mine that posted this verse, verse 1 of Psalm 18, on Thanksgiving Day. And I thought, that's a great place for us to kind of start out and meditate on this for a few minutes together as we celebrate this Thanksgiving weekend. It's beginning to look like Christmas around here, though. You can see Shelby, I think, and Jesse have been doing some work and kind of getting us into the spirit of Christmas, and everybody is wanting to brighten things up a little bit on a year like this anyway. So the way this psalm begins is with a beautiful verse. It says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his loving kindness is everlasting." And then in those four verses, it repeats basically the same thing. His loving kindness is everlasting. His loving kindness is everlasting. His loyal, steadfast, covenant-keeping, promise-keeping love is everlasting. That's the kind of God that we're giving thanks to. So the command is we should give thanks to a God who is good, and a God who is loyal in his love to us. Now, many Bible scholars believe that that's the last song that Jesus sang with his disciples in the upper room the night of that Passover meal and the institution of the Lord's Supper. So this last supper that he had, it says they sang a hymn, and then they went up to the Mount of Olives, up to the Garden of Gethsemane. So if that's true, then what we're reading here is something that Jesus would have sung with his disciples on the night of the Last Supper. The writer of the song tells us what we should do in times of distress. So he goes on in verse 5, and he says, "From my distress I called upon the Lord, and the Lord answered me and set me in a large place." If you're reading from the ESV, I think it says, "and set me free." The imagery I got in my mind there in a time of distress is kind of like being put in a squeeze chute and then crying out to the Lord for help, and he opens the chute and he turns you loose in a big pasture. So yeah, this is a place, a large place, a place of freedom, and yet the Lord answered his prayer when he cried out for help. So I'm going to ask you some questions as we go through this. In this past year, this has kind of been a stressful year for many of us in different ways, and things that normally look one way have looked totally different. This is the first year that Bonnie and I have ever spent Thanksgiving just the two of us together, and the Lord gave us a delightful time, but still different than the way it typically is. How has the Lord answered your prayer, and put you in a large pasture during a stressful time, during a stressful year. Is there anything you've been through that's been distressful and God answered your prayer? That'd be a good thing to share a little bit later in the service. As the psalmist goes on, the writer says in verses 6 and 7 that the Lord is on his side. Now, instead of reading from the New American Standard, I want to read it in the ESV because I like the way it said it there. The Lord is on my side. I will not fear. What can man do to me? The Lord is on my side as my helper. So, if the Lord is on your side, there's no way you're going to lose. And he says, the Lord is on my side. The Lord has been my helper. The Lord is the one that's helped me to overcome my fears. So, I don't know, we're all wired differently, and we all probably have different kinds of fear, but most of us struggle with fear one way or another. So, when the Lord is on our side, what kind of fears has he helped you to be able to overcome? This past year or throughout your life, have there been a time when it seemed like fear was almost paralyzing and you cried out to God and realized that the Lord is on your side and therefore you have a helper and he's helped you to overcome your fears? In verses 8 and 9, look at what he goes on to say here. We all need a refuge to run to. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. If we put our trust in man, we're going to be disappointed. If we put our trust in politicians, we are going to be sorely disappointed. We better be putting our trust in the Lord and finding our refuge in him. We run to all kinds of things for refuge, and some things are not good shelters. The Lord is the one who provides a refuge for us, and we should put our trust in him. How has the Lord been your refuge, and have you run to him this last year, looking over this last year of your life, or some particular crisis that maybe God has taken you through in days gone by? How has the Lord proven to be our refuge? And then go on down to verse 21 and notice what it says there. Lord, our salvation. Verse 21. I shall give thanks to you, for you have answered me and you have become my salvation. The lyrics of that are similar to what he says in verse 14. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. So, from what Ryan was sharing earlier, think about maybe you've come to that point of crisis in your life where you cried out for mercy and your biggest need was met and you were saved. That our biggest need is forgiveness because our biggest problem is sin, rebellion against God. And if we cry out for mercy, God is unbelievably gracious to be able to grant forgiveness for our sins. Has he rescued you from your biggest problem, from separation from God himself? And if so, how did God save you? You might want to share that as we have an open mic time. How has God saved you and rescued you from sin? How did he rescue us? That's Psalm 118 pulls verses together that gives imagery of what Christ was going to do when he came. So look at verse 22. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. So the imagery there is, they're working on the temple or they're working on a building, and the mason himself is walking around and there's this one stone there, and he looks at it and says, no, that'd never work out as a cornerstone. I've got to find something else. So they look for, that one is rejected. But finally, God is the one that overrules, and that stone becomes the cornerstone, and it sets the dimensions for the building. Everything connects into that stone. Everything is built upon that stone. So this verse is quoted multiple times in the New Testament in reference to the Lord Jesus Christ himself, who became the cornerstone. And what God did when he laid this stone is marvelous in our eyes. So here's the question. How has Christ proven to be the cornerstone of your life? And are you building your life around this cornerstone of Christ? Is he the most important thing? And everything in your life connects into him and is dependent upon him. This is marvelous in our eyes. Christ is our cornerstone. In verse 24, there's a familiar verse, and this is what it says. This is the day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Now, that follows after the cornerstone, what is marvelous in his eyes, in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I think it's pointing towards Christ himself and what he did and when he came. And so what happens is when he offers himself to Jerusalem and he comes riding in, not on a white horse, but on the back of a donkey. And if you've ever seen donkeys, what's interesting, many of them on their back have a cross on the back of a donkey. Christ is mounted on a donkey. They're taking their coats off or cloaks off, putting them in the road. Palm branches are being waved, and they're putting them down as he rides in. And the children are singing, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." In other words, they're proclaiming him to be the Messiah, the long-awaited Redeemer, the King of Israel. And so that is in this psalm as well. Look at verse 26. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. The children were singing this song when Jesus rides into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey. So, this is a day which the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is truly a Thanksgiving song. Look at verse 28. You are my God, and I give thanks to you. You are my God, and I extol you. What struck me there is, my God, my God. It is personalized. The writer of this song is saying, I have a personal relationship with God. I find my joy. My joy flows from this personal relationship with him. Our praise would flow out of a personal relationship with the Lord. And so when we share today, it should be shared from hearts that are overflowing because we have a personal relationship with my God, my God. I'll give thanks to you and I will extol you, O Lord. So where it begins, it also ends. So the song starts with a verse and it ends with the same verse. And so in verse 29 we read, command, he says, give thanks to the Lord. Why? For he is good. Why? Because his loving kindness, his loyal love, his steadfast love is everlasting. He's a promise-keeping God who never stops loving his children. And so we have much to give thanks for. So, thinking about Psalm 118, applying it into the context of giving public praise to God, which Israel did a lot of, and that's what we want to do today as well. Here are some things that we should think about. We'll give you 1 minute, 60 seconds of praise. Sometimes people go a minute and a half, though. You might get away with two. But here's some things to think about. How has the Lord been good to you? How has the Lord shown his loyal love to you? How has the Lord been your refuge in time of distress and set you free from fear? How has the Lord been your helper, your strength, your song, and your salvation? How has the Lord become the cornerstone of your life, and everything that you do is built around Him, around Christ Himself? So what I'm going to do is ask you to think about that, give you a little bit of time, and we're going to play one of Jim Reeves' old songs that says, Lord, we thank you. So be thinking about this, and then we're going to have an open mic time right after that, okay?
That run all day. Thank thee for the little birds that sing along the way. Thank thee for the trees and the deep blue sea, O Lord, we thank thee. Oh yes, we thank thee, Lord, for every flower that blooms, birds that sing, fish that swim, and the light of the moon. We thank thee every day as we kneel and pray that we were born with eyes to see these things. Thank thee for the fields where the clover is grown. Thank thee for the pastures where cattle may roam. Thank thee for thy love so pure and free, O Lord, we thank thee. Oh yes, we thank thee, Lord, for every flower that blooms, birds that sing, fish that swim, and the light of the moon. We thank thee every day as we kneel and pray that we were born with eyes to see these things. Yes, we thank thee for the fields where the clover is grown. Thank thee for the pastures where cattle may roam. Thank thee for thy love so pure and so free, O Lord, we
going to have an opportunity to do that. I'll turn those lights back on here in just a second to try to do that. But this is just an open mic time, and so what I would encourage you to do is you can either come stand, if you're on this side, come stand right over here by the Christmas tree there, or on this side you can come stand over here by the cross, and then just take turns coming up and sharing something you want to say. I want to publicly thank God for, and then you fill in the blank there. But this is a great opportunity for us to give glory to God for His goodness to us. So somebody needs to be first. That's the main thing. All right? Get us going. Now, thank you, Doug. All right. Who wants to be second?
Wow. I guess we really have to be thankful for a lot of things, which I am. It's very trying times right now for all of us. Very, very difficult. So I hope I can get through this. First and foremost, I thank God for everything that I have, for my health, for my family, for every living being that surrounds me. But most of all, I want to say that I say this prayer every day, and it gets me through every day, because it's just been really tough. You are my morning soul, You crush the enemy. You're my sword and my shield, which gives me faith. My strength and my name, the God of ancient armies. You hold the whole world in your hands. You are faithful. I hold on to your promises. I know who goes before me, and I know who stands behind me. Everlasting, undying love.
Well, this has been a trying year because of COVID a little bit, and then these elections, and you know, there's just been so many changes, and I think for those of us that are getting long in the tooth, it's we're stunned by what we see in the world around us. We would say if you'd told us 10 years ago that this would be the state of affairs of a country, we wouldn't believe it. And about the time that I would get to the point of real despair and then turn that into sort of an anger, my wife would remind me that God is sovereign and none of this is happening outside of his control. And I thank the Lord that I can hear what's going on. I listen less to the radio. I don't watch the television anymore. But I can be confident that God is in control. And he is the cornerstone. And things don't just happen, do they? And so I'm thankful for that.
I'm thankful for a lot of things this year. I know 2020 has not been a good year, but for me it was a piece of cake because 2019 wasn't a good year for me. And I went through some stuff, and the Lord is sufficient and gracious and merciful. And I just want to share a scripture real quick out of Lamentations. I read this morning. For men are not cast off by the Lord forever. Though he brings grief, he will show compassion. So great is his unfailing love, for he does not willingly bring affliction or grief to the children of men. Lamentations was not a happy book. Babylon came in, captured, and the people that were left in Jerusalem were destitute. And the author of Lamentations gave several nuggets, and we have those same today. Thank you.
Well, this certainly has been a strange year. I want to give thanks to my Savior. He's done an awful good job of keeping me in line and keeping us safe and providing for us. I could stand up here lots longer than 2 minutes and list in all the things that God has been faithful about. But we got some good news. Earlier on this year, surprising news, my oldest daughter, Mandy, said she was going to have twins. They already have a boy and a girl, a 5-year-old and a 3-year-old, and that's all they were going to have. And my son-in-law was going to go in for the snip job, and that was going to be it for, you know, they were just going to have a family of four. Well, the Lord's plans are not always our plans. And anyway, they said they're going to have identical boys. Hopefully they won't look too much like me, but we're looking forward to that. They're supposed to have them about Christmas time. So her last day of work was just, I think, yesterday. And she has to go in twice a week for an hour as they monitor the baby's heart rates. So far, everything's going well, but depending on how their heart rates go, then they said, you know, if she hasn't had them by the 30th of December, then they're going to take them. But anyway, we praise the Lord for that, and that's just one of many things the Lord has been good to us about this year.
I'm thankful for the strength that God has given us to build our house and hopefully be able to move in tomorrow, since we've been living in a trailer for a long time.
Well, this last year, it has been a challenge, I know, for everyone. And I think the thing that really was most wonderful about it all was the fact that I knew all these things were going to come. The Bible tells us all about it. It's all got a wonderful ending. And the stretch between now and then, we're not sure of. But when I realized that these things that were in our Bible were happening very quickly, it confirms, of course, to myself, which I already believe, but other people. And I think it's happening now that more people who are not believers are beginning to see the truth of the Bible and maybe kind of questioning, this is a little scary, what do I do next? And so I realize that we're in a very intense spiritual battle. I realize that when I listen to the news and the politics are looking pretty black and white to me. And I'm amazed at how so many people don't even see that. So I'm just looking at this as the beginning of a spiritual battle and an opportunity to share Christ with more people and be thankful that we have the answer. We have the end of the Bible, and it's a wonderful, blessed hope.
This year, we just finished up a sermon series out of the book of Ruth. And, you know, Ruth is kind of one of those books that often gets overlooked. But, you know, God's timing of reopening that book and really studying and digging down into the Word is amazing, that he would choose to bring that book of Ruth, a book of hope, just like hope that's not based on any person or human. It's fully based on our Redeemer in this season, where I think there's been a lot of people that have lost hope. And I know for me, I'm somebody that sometimes misplaces my hope. I put my hope in circumstances or even misplaced hope in your husband and, you know, what, how he can fill you up, or your kids and what they're doing. And Ruth is the first Bible study. 6 weeks after my first husband passed away, I walked in to a Bible study, and I didn't know what it was going to be, and they opened this book, and it said, "You have a hope." And it was just so encouraging to walk through that with my family in the church, knowing some of your hearts and where you're struggling. And I just was so encouraged to have you encourage me, but also to look around and look for an opportunity to share those experiences and those promises from his word. And one thing I just, about that time, I think Pastor Wayne and Bonnie went on their 3-week trip back east, and Pastor Wayne came back and he shared about some of the relatives in his family. And I don't remember the first name, but it was Mrs. Pickens, Becky Pickens. And on her tombstone, it was engraved, it said, "She died humbly, relying upon the mercy of her Redeemer." And I was sitting over there where I often sit, and the Holy Spirit just hit me like a ton of bricks, and it said, "You know what? I want to live humbly, relying upon the mercy of my Redeemer." And so often I live relying upon hope that I've placed in somebody besides my Lord and my Redeemer. So I'm just encouraged that when we hang our hope on something, it's far bigger than ourselves or our circumstances. But we have a God that is, he is on his throne, and he is in complete control, and he hears our prayers. So I just think that's something that was really encouraging to me, and maybe it can encourage you to live humbly, relying upon the mercy of your Redeemer. For hope does not disappoint.
Mary and I were trying to remember the special things about Thanksgiving as we were growing up. You know, we went for a couple of decades not getting to celebrate Thanksgiving like we did when we were kids. And so we were reminiscing. And my favorite thing about Thanksgiving was the prep time in the kitchen before the meal, where all the members of the family are helping, and the anticipation of the meal. You know, we got way more food than we can eat, and all different varieties and specialty. Everybody's making their special dish. It's just the prep time was important. And I was thinking, we're kind of in a prep time now. Someday we're going to be sitting at a banquet table. And I called up my sisters to wish them happy Thanksgiving. And I could hear them arguing over how to make the rolls. You know, how long they're supposed to rise and what temperature. They were arguing. And I was thinking, wow, that's what a shame, because that's the best time of Thanksgiving is the prep time. So my encouragement is we're in the best time right now. And let's not argue. Let's just enjoy the prep.
Thinking about it, just go ahead and come on up. Right there on the edge. finish it up today, so Bob, why don't you come on up and
we'll share. Well, this is a 2020 is a big year for us. I'll
turn mine back on. There you go. 2020 is a big year for us. Most of you know this was our 50th wedding anniversary year, and the big party was supposed to happen in June at the time of that, but because of the COVID, that got postponed into August, and instead of a big gathering, it turned out to be a small gathering in the yard. We had a delightful evening the Lord provided for us and great memories. Then an anniversary trip that was supposed to happen in the spring postponed to September, and we had a chance to go to Kentucky and South Carolina and track down family history, and then ended up in Texas where I got a chance to be able to see my mom, 97 years old and still going strong, and just a great time with family there. So much to be thankful for as we look back over this last year. But it just got me to thinking about God's faithfulness through the transitions of life. I'm more of a country boy, and I married a city girl. And the first couple of years were whitewater years, and God got us through it without killing each other. And he taught us how to be able to live together, and now it's just amazing how much alike we are. And then the children began to come, and that was a transition. Then four different churches, and each of those churches had different transitions between them and how the Lord provided for us in that. This Homestead chapter has been one of the most delightful of all. But we look back 50 years of marriage, but really 50 years of ministry together. 46 of those have been pastor and wife years that we look back on, and how God has been so faithful to bless us along the way through all the ups and downs of what we've been through through together that way. So now I am especially thankful that as we are kind of making another transition step, I've kind of been the head coach, and I'm stepping down and becoming the assistant coach, but God sent Brock and Heidi to us, and I am so thankful that I can pass the baton on to somebody that is as godly and gifted and works hard to prepare in order to feed the flock in God's family, and I just know Brock's going to be a great head coach, and look forward to the privilege of being able to work alongside of them. And our elders will be working as a team with Brock. And so as of January, we're making that transition formally here, and we'll kind of have a commissioning time the last Sunday in December for Brock and Heidi. But I want to publicly thank God. They said, if you're at your age going to plant a church and start a church, you better be looking for a young man real quick that can kind of pick up the slack and take it on from there. And God sent Brock and Heidi. I'm thankful to God for that. Bon? Okay.
Oops. Well, I am thankful for four things, but I'll make it really, really quick. This last year, I'm thankful for the Word of God. This last year, as I have done my quiet times in the morning, the word that I have read over and over again just has stood out to me, and I have totally enjoyed just reading through His Word. It is spoken to me. There's a song that goes, the Word is life, and it has been life-giving for me. I also am thankful for this man right here, man of 50 years. God has blessed, and I am so, so grateful for that. And I am so thankful for Homestead. You are such a blessing to us. Most of you, we did not know when this church started in September of 2012. We did not know you, and you have come, and we have loved you, and we just appreciate you all so very much, and those listening at home as well. Then, Wayne mentioned that in January and February of this next year, we are going to take a little sabbatical. Well, one of the words, one of the phrases in Ruth that Heidi was talking about is, it just so happened. Mm-hmm. And it just so happened in Ruth that Ruth was gleaning in Boaz's field, and you know that story. Well, it just so happened that Heidi has a brother named Jesse. And we had checked out one area down in Imnaha where we thought we might stay for a couple months. And that just didn't work out, plus the fact that there's no cell phone coverage, and our kids weren't really excited about us being off-grid for 2 months. And so we were driving back up, and Wayne and I were just down, and we weren't talking and everything. And then it just, well, Jesse, Heidi's brother, Jesse, has this place that was just given to him by a gracious lady, because they had been so gracious to this lady. This lady willed to them a house and acreage. And where is that? Well, where does Jesse live? Well, so Wayne he's trying to find Jesse's house, and we hadn't been there in ages. We finally drive down the lane, and there's the post office box, his mailbox right there, Jesse Miller. And so we're parked alongside of the road, and Wayne says, should I drive down the lane? Oh, I just don't feel like talking to anybody right now. I'm just down. I just don't. And when it just so happened that Jesse and his whole family are in the pickup truck, and they're driving down the lane. They're driving down their lane. So he rolls down his window, Wayne and Bonnie, what are you doing here? And it's the Lord ordained that. And this is hilarious. I got to act it out. They're going elk hunting. All four of them are in the car. Sure. Their truck. They're going elk hunting, and he starts digging in his pocket, and he says, I've got just the thing for you. And he's carrying the keys to the house in his pocket as he's going elk hunting, for crying out loud. So he hands them over, and he said, go check this house out. I think you'll love it. And we did. And so that is where Wayne and I spent this Thanksgiving week, just last week, as kind of a test run for that. And so we are so grateful that the Lord ordained that we would stay, in Jesse's graciousness, that we would be able to stay in this house for January and February. One more thing that while we were there in Joseph, Wayne and I were reading our blessing box blessings when we either have Christmas with the whole family or Thanksgiving with the whole family. We write down little blessings. We date it and we put our name on it, and then it goes into the blessing box. Well, we were reading all of these, and the thing that stuck, that impressed me also, was the fact that my mom and dad were very instrumental in my brothers and my life growing up, their spiritual influence on us, but not only us, but our grandmother children as well. And as different as Wayne and I are, city and country, we both came from homes that value family. And that's a treasure. That is a treasure. And so I'm just grateful for all of these things, but I want to leave you with one verse that is just so special. It's in 2 Thessalonians 3:5, and it says, may the Lord direct your hearts into the love of God and into the steadfastness of Christ.
Amen. Amen. Why don't you just head on up? Worship team's going to come back up and sing a couple songs for us here in closing. What I might just say at the end is, Jesus was about to make a great big transition in his life, and he said to his disciples, I am not alone. The Father is with me. And I've said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world, you will have tribulation, but take courage. I have Nike'd the world. And that's how we get through the transitions of life, right there. That's Jesus set the example for us. So why don't we sing a couple of songs in closing here, Mark?
You can sit on this one, and then I know you're going to want to stand on the last one.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You feed me, clothe me, keep me warm. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You are so good to me. You keep me safe and light my way. You give me rest. You help me pray. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. You are so good to me. You are good and your mercy never fails, never fails. It is new every morning, hallelujah. You give me all I need and more, you are so good to me. Thank you, Jesus, thank you, Lord. You forgive and you restore. Thank you, Jesus, thank you, Lord. You are so good to me. When I'm drowning in despair, you lift your head and show your care. Thank you, Jesus, thank you, Lord. You are so good to me. You are good and your mercy never fails, never fails. It is new every morning, hallelujah. You give me all I need and more, you are so good to me. You hold the stars and moon in place to give us light and show your grace. The rivers, trees, and mountains raise their voice to you in endless praise. The beauty of this earth you made moves me to lift my hands and say, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Lord, you are so good to me. You are good and your mercy never fails, never fails. It is new every morning, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You are Lord. I humbly worship and adore. Your blessings are forevermore. You are so good.
Please stand on this last one.
Thou, O Lord, our God, above all the earth, Thou art exalted. Far above all God. Thou, O Lord, our God, above all the earth. Thou art exalted, far above all God.
One to sing in a hot tub with tile all the way around. So you better work that into your house somehow then. There you go. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the gracious good Lord make his face to shine upon you and be totally gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all.